The Senate will come to order. I ask everyone present to please rise and recite the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
In the absence of clergy, let us bow our heads in a moment of silent reflection or prayer. Reading of the journal.
In Senate, Monday, March 2nd, 2020, the Senate met pursuant to adjournment. The journal of Sunday, March 1st, 2020 was read and approved. On motion, Senate adjourned.
Without objection, the journal stands approved as read. Presentation of petitions, messages from the Assembly, messages from the Governor, reports of standing committees, reports of select committees, communications and reports from state officers, motions and resolutions. Senator Janaris.
Mr. President, there will be an immediate meeting of the Rules Committee in room 332.
There'll be an immediate meeting of the Rules Committee in room 332.
The Senate will stand at ease.
The Senate will stand at ease. The Senate will return to order. Senator Janaris.
The report of the Rules Committee at the desk.
There is a report of the Rules Committee at the desk. The Secretary will read.
Senator Stuart Cousins from the Committee on Rules reports the following bill. Senate Print 7919 by Senator Stuart Cousins, an act to amend the executive law.
All in favor of accepting the Committee on Rules report signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The report is accepted and before the House.
Please take up the supplemental calendar.
The Secretary will read.
Calendar number 524, Senate Print 7919 by Senator Stuart Cousins, an act to amend the executive law.
Lay it aside. Senator Janaris, that completes the reading of today's supplemental calendar.
Please take up the controversial calendar.
The Secretary will ring the bell. The Secretary will read.
Calendar number 524, Senate Print 7919 by Senator Stuart Cousins, an act to amend the executive law.
Necessity at the desk, Mr. President.
There is a message of necessity at the desk.
I should say a message of necessity as well as a message of appropriation. I move to accept them both.
All in favor of accepting the message of necessity and appropriation signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay.
Nay.
The message is accepted and the bill is before the House. Senator Flanagan.
Thank you, Mr. President. Will the sponsor yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes.
The sponsor yields.
Mr. President, I have a series of questions, and I'm more than happy to go through the chair. Am I correct that Senator Janaris is the sponsor?
The sponsor is Leader Stuart Cousins, but I will be answering questions, Mr. President.
I think we have to go through a little bit of a painstaking discussion because this sort of redefines message of necessity. And let me start by asking Senator Janaris, who negotiated this bill?
Let me first, since the Senator Flanagan mentioned it, yes, I do believe this issue redefines message of necessity because we are at an incredibly necessary moment in dealing with a crisis that's engulfing the whole world and has reached New York. I have sat in this chamber for over a decade watching all sorts of nonsensical messages of necessity be accepted by the very same people who are now trying to debate this bill, which is trying to deal with a public health crisis that is on the verge of becoming much more than of a problem than it already is. So to answer the second question or comment that Senator Flanagan made, the bill was negotiated just like all other bills are negotiated by members and staff on the majority side of the Senate and the Assembly.
So I'm looking at the, is it fair to say that the genesis of this legislation is the public health crisis that you alluded to, which I acknowledge and certainly feel that we should be addressing. But at the root of that, would it not be the coronavirus that has engulfed the world, now the United States of America, and by extension, the state of New York?
That's correct.
Okay. So I'm looking at the title of this bill that was negotiated by the usual course of action, according to the sponsor. And it says, the title is, it relates to issuing by the governor of any directive necessary to respond to a state disaster emergency. And then I read the language in here that clearly allows the governor, by executive order, to issue any directive, more than an executive order. And he can do so during a state disaster emergency that goes well beyond the coronavirus. This is far more sweeping than dealing with the public health issues involving the coronavirus. So why would this majority grant unfettered discretion, unbridled authority, and cede our power as a directly elected legislative body to the executive in a much broader and much more sweeping fashion than is necessary to deal with the coronavirus?
Wow, so many misstatements that it's going to take me a little while to respond. And Senator Flanagan knows better because he served long enough in the legislature. His first point about the title of the bill, as he well knows, the bill amends a section of existing law. So it says it is an act to amend the executive law as it relates to when the governor gets to issue directives dealing with state disaster emergencies, because it is in the section of New York state law, in the executive law, that deals with disaster declarations. That is why the title is what it is, because we're amending a section of law that deals with the broader subject matter. Secondly, Senator Flanagan said it goes beyond executive order. The law, or the bill, by its very word, says the governor, by executive order, may issue such directives. So any action taken by the governor will be by executive order. Next, he said it would be unbridled authority. Well, again, as Senator Flanagan should know, in the law itself, in Section 4, it says very clearly, the legislature may terminate by concurrent resolution executive orders issued under this section at any time. So that is hardly unbridled. There is a check and balance that the legislature has over this process. And should the governor issue an executive order with which we disagree and with which the assembly disagrees, we can revoke that at any time by act of the legislature.
Mr. President, through you, if the sponsor will continue to yield.
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes.
The sponsor yields.
I'm looking at page 3, line 4. Disaster means occurrence or imminent, impending, or urgent threat. What is an impending or urgent threat? Because there are a number of my colleagues who feel that imminent is vastly different from impending or urgent, and impending may be giving powers to the executive for something that may never happen or may never occur. Why would that language be expanded to give more power to the executive?
We are dealing with a crisis that has already visited other nations in the world and that is currently spreading through the west coast of this country, and we know has people who have contracted this virus in New York State already. I don't think it's time to play politics and screw around and allow a dispute to exist as to whether or not a situation is particularly imminent. What is the definition of imminent, some might say? Is one person contracting the virus in Manhattan who's under house quarantine an imminent threat or not? We're trying to solve something before it gets to the point where people start dying in our state. And I would think that would be something that everyone in this chamber could understand the importance of doing. Now, you want to vote against this. That's your right as a member of the legislature. You can do that. But you are fond of saying on that side of the aisle, inaccurately for the most part, when consequences lead to horrific results based on what we do here. We're trying to avoid that. We're trying to be responsible and say there is something that is brewing in the world that has reached New York. Okay, we are dealing with, yes, an impending crisis, but perhaps not in the strict definition, an imminent crisis. And we are trying to make sure that the law provides opportunity for this state to take action to protect its citizens, which is what we're here to do.
Mr. President, will the sponsor continue to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes.
I'm going to preface my question by saying I just listened to 3 responses, and I let each one of them pass. Not playing politics, not screwing around, not playing any kind of games. I'm actually trying to have a debate and have real discussion on something that has not been discussed in here at all. So if you want to go down that path, I'm all ready to go down that path. This is not about politics. And in fact, this is one of the few occasions where I can say the chief executive of the state has been complimentary of the federal government and complimented the appointment of Vice President Pence to head the coronavirus issue and task force at the federal level.
Mr. President, though I do find it ironic, he said he's not playing politics and then spent the next 30 seconds talking about how great the federal government is. But please, go on.
Mr. President, will the sponsor continue to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes.
The sponsor yields.
Senator Gennaris, I'm looking at specific portions of this legislation. The governor can now, under law, under this bill that you negotiated, he can suspend an entire statute, which gives him broader and more explicit authority than he has under present law. And in fact, it says under current law, specific provisions of any statute. Now it just says any statute. That is a broader authority than the governor presently have, which would allow him to suspend any statute, not only involving the coronavirus, because it says it could be on fire, flood, earthquake, hurricane, tornado, high water, landslide, mudslide, windstorm, wave action, volcanic activity. You're giving the governor power to suspend any statute. That is a broader discretion of authority being given to him. Why would you do this when we're dealing with the coronavirus? That doesn't have anything to do with wind.
Mr. President, Senator Flanagan is once again mistaken. The power to suspend specific provisions of any statute which existed previously gave the governor the power to suspend every specific provision of a specific statute if he so chose to do.
Then why did you take that language out?
So in fact, this is not anything that has any great substantive value in terms of difference from pre-existing law, which has been here. And by the way, I heard the senator read through the list of disasters. Is the senator suggesting we do not want to worry about those disasters that have been in law for many, many years? Do you not want to protect people from hurricanes, earthquakes, et cetera?
The sponsor answered me to yield. That was happy to yield to a question if there is a question.
That was a rhetorical question, Mr. President. Let me make it as a statement. Seems to me that Senator Flanagan does not care about whether or not New Yorkers are adequately protected against hurricanes, earthquakes, floods, et cetera, as listed in the statute.
Is the statement and the rhetorical part done? Because I'd like to continue. Mr. President, through you.
Are you asking the sponsor to yield?
I'm asking the sponsor to yield. Yes, I am.
Sponsor yield.
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
All those occurrences and potentialities are covered in existing law. You're granting broader and deeper authority to the executive to go well beyond what's in existing law. All those things that were mentioned, fire, flood, earthquake, hurricane, tornado, Senator Gennaris, I don't question your passion on issues. So don't do it to me. I know exactly where all of these are. I know exactly what the current law is. And frankly, I don't need to be schooled on what the law is. I'm reading the existing statute. And all of those are right there. And why could this not have been simply legislation that with all those other things, under definition of a disaster, you add disease outbreak and leave it at that? You're giving all this new written authority, including any directive that heretofore does not exist. You're saying the governor could do it already. Well, if he could do it already, you wouldn't be amending the statute. You wouldn't be putting all this new language in. So yes, I care very deeply about the very same things that you do. We go at it from a different level. I believe it's in the purview of this legislative body to actually enact legislation and not give our authority away to the governor. So why couldn't you not simply just add disease outbreak?
I've sat here for over a decade, most of the years in the minority, watching the then majority cede power to the governor day after day in this chamber. You know, we're dealing with a Medicaid redesign task force proposal this year. It's called MRT2 because there was an MRT1.
Mr. President, is this pertinent or germane to this legislation?
It absolutely is, Mr. President. If he's talking about ceding control to the governor, you better believe we're going to talk about who ceded control to the governor when you didn't complain about it. And I'm sorry, Senator Flanagan, but if you're making mistakes about what the law says, I am going to school you on it because we're going to set the facts straight as it relates to this debate. So there was a Medicaid redesign task force that ceded control to the governor for 10 years that your majority passed. For the last 10 years, the executive has been making cuts to health care in this state without the proper legislative authority. You didn't have a problem then. We're sitting here today dealing with a current impending crisis in our state and, frankly, in the world. And if we don't take the steps necessary to deal with it today, then there's going to be consequences well beyond the borders of our state, but certainly for the millions of people that live here. Now, like I said, yeah, you want to play politics, you go right ahead and do it. Vote how you want. That's your right in this body. But we're going to do the right thing and make sure that New Yorkers are protected.
Mr. President, will the sponsor continue to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes.
The sponsor yields.
Why is this authority granted for 13 months? We heard an original version of this bill gave power to the governor throughout the balance of his term. How did you end up coming up with 13 months through the end of next April?
I appreciate Senator Flanagan pointing out that the negotiations led to more stringent controls and checks and balances than were initially proposed. So as a result of negotiations, that was we settled on the time in the bill.
Why not 60 days or 90? Through you, Mr. President.
The sponsor yield.
Why not 60 or 90 days? Why give over a year's authority to the executive?
That is where the negotiations concluded. And let me remind the senator once again that there is a provision in the existing law that will remain there that allows the legislature at any time to rescind an executive order of the governor as it relates to this section of law. That could be one day, that could be 10 days, that could be 30 days. Whenever we decide that we don't support something that's been done, we can revoke it.
And I would remind the sponsor that the current law allows the executive to spend it.
Are you asking the sponsor to yield?
Yes.
But does the sponsor yield?
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
Under current law, an executive order allows for suspension of a provision of a statute. This new law allows the directive to create new law without legislation. The governor can unilaterally act on virtually any subject matter having nothing to do with the coronavirus. The governor could suspend an election, which he has done before. This would give him the authority to do that with more discretion than in the past. Why would you do that?
I hope the senator is not suggesting that the election that was canceled on 9/11 should not have been canceled.
He wasn't governor, and I know exactly what I was referring to, and that was not it.
Okay, but the power to cancel elections, which Senator Flanagan seems so concerned about, was used with great notice on 9/11. So there are reasons that the powers are there. And there's a good example of why it was inconvenient or impossible for a legislature to convene to take such action. There are moments of crisis that require dramatic and quick action on behalf of the state. And to suggest that he can do it anytime for anywhere, I'm afraid Senator Flanagan is not reading Subdivision 2 of the law, which lists numerous restrictions on this power, including it to 30 days at a time, that the suspension be directly related to the emergency declared, and I won't read them all because it'll take too long, but it goes up to subdivision F. So what is that, 6 or 7 restrictions on this power?
Will the sponsor yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
How is the $40 million going to be appropriated? Who's going to make that determination? Is money going to go to Brooklyn? Is it going to go to Binghamton? Is it going to go to the North Country? Are we giving all that power to the governor? Are we giving it to the Commissioner of Health? Who's going to be able to weigh in?
The governor's decision, I presume he will consult with his appropriate experts.
Will the sponsor continue?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes.
The sponsor yields.
Will there be any legislative input as to the distribution of those funds? Because you're acknowledging that this is all going to be within the jurisdiction of the governor and the Department of Health and the Commissioner of Health.
The legislative input is happening tonight. We are appropriating $40 million to deal with the coronavirus crisis.
With no legislative oversight.
The senator and his colleagues are certainly welcome to vote yes or no on this bill. Just like when we pass a budget later this month, we'll be voting yes or no on billions of dollars of appropriations, some with greater specificity listed than others. In this case, this money is going to deal with the coronavirus crisis.
Mr. President, would the sponsor continue to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes.
The sponsor yields.
In the budget that was passed last year, I want to cite the page correctly. I think this is accurate, but the sum is not in dispute. I'm looking at page 743, miscellaneous all state departments and agencies, special emergency appropriation. Sum of $1 billion is hereby appropriated solely for transfer by the governor to the general, special revenue, capital projects, proprietary or fiduciary funds to meet unanticipated emergencies pursuant to Section 53 of the state finance law. That seems to cover more than is certainly more that's being asked for in this legislation. Speaks to unanticipated emergencies. Why would the legislature now provide $40 million when there's $1 billion of appropriation authority that already exists?
This is an appropriation that's very specific to the coronavirus crisis, and that's where this money is dedicated. That larger pot is for other potential emergencies.
So, would the sponsor continue
to
yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes.
Sponsor yield.
Under this section, it gives the governor discretion for $1 billion. You don't believe that he has the discretion right now to address this emergency or some similarly situated emergency like flooding?
No, I didn't say that, Mr. President. I just said we are specifically allocating $40 million tonight for the coronavirus crisis, and that larger pot is there to deal with other potential emergencies.
On the bill.
Senator Flanagan, on the bill.
Thank you, Senator Gennaris. You know, it's interesting to listen to my own comments, let alone those of Senator Gennaris. I'm going to speak to the contents of this legislation, and then I'm going to speak to the process. And I'm going to talk about the here and now and what we're looking at and what we're seeing, what we're debating, and what we are actually going to be called to vote upon. And I found it interesting that the senator made a lot of suppositions about what I may think or how I may vote, and there's probably a good reason, because he wouldn't know. I just saw this bill less than 2 hours ago. Certainly it hasn't been out there for public review. There's been no public hearings. And it's not as if this issue materialized overnight. It's been out there for weeks. But somehow today it became so paramount that we had to do a message of necessity, bypass an entire process, and be doing this bill now. There was not one member, and I will not speak for any of my Democratic colleagues, there was not one member in our conference who isn't deeply concerned about the public health and welfare of their constituents and of all the constituents of the state of New York. There is not one member of our conference who doesn't believe that we should do everything within our power to help bring about and effectuate change. And one of the ways we can do that is by having facts and figures and statistics and input. We only got a smattering of that 1 hour ago. The Commissioner of Health was gracious enough to come over and give us some background details. So we know what's involved. We know what the governor has said. We know what's coming from the federal government. And I don't, like my colleagues on the other side, find it a laughing matter. I was not the one sitting here snickering as I'm laying out some comments. This is a real public health crisis. It's a governmental crisis, and how we respond is critically important. If this were only about the coronavirus, great. It needs to be addressed. If this were only about appropriation authority to the tune of $40 million, great. If this were only about giving the governor discretion on that $40 million, I get it. But I ask the question for a specific reason, because there may be acuity of circumstance in any one of your districts or any one of ours where we might want to actually have input and some legislative involvement. The problem with this legislation is not its goal. It's how we get there. This changes New York State law radically, not superficially, not marginally, not even subliminally. It's right out there. The governor's being given far more power and authority than he's ever had. The governor's being given far more power than he deserves. And the idea that there'll be a concurrent resolution that can be spent at any time, that's going to be really, really hard to achieve. And I don't think we should have that provision, because I don't think we should have this law. Because this law is not about the coronavirus. It's about far more than that. When a legislative body says the governor can suspend any statute in its entirety, we better really, really be careful. Because then we don't matter. And imminent is a lot different than impending or urgent. This gives the governor far more power than either the Senate or the Assembly. I don't believe for a second that that is in the best interest of the people we represent. And I know a number of my colleagues are going to say, you're playing politics. I'm not. And we're not. I know we need to do something. But I don't want to be a member in this body, an elected member of this body, and say the governor has all this authority. And yeah, the idea that it can be done for 30 days, that's already in law. I know it's already in law. I don't have to see that underlined or bracketed. He has the power to issue that executive order. But now he can do it, and you're giving him that authority for almost 14 months. Statutorily, you're giving the governor more authority. And to say, well, you know it was going to be till the end of his term, but we fought back, and it's only 13 months, I don't think that's good enough. I don't think that's in the best interest of the people that we represent or our responsibility as being members in this body. This is the type of legislation that seemingly is innocuous in many respects. And it goes beyond executive orders. It uses the word directive on multiple occasions. And the governor is the one that gets to determine what is reasonable and necessary, not anybody else. There's no standard here other than what the governor and his executive agencies think. I believe the public expects better of us. Do I think we need to act? Yes. And I will not take a backseat to anyone in our efforts to try and address issues like this in a timely and detailed and compassionate fashion. I am sure that some of my colleagues want to speak on this bill. I am glad that we are actually having this discussion, because there have been no discussions prior to this. And Senator Gennaris, I came in here today, found out about this, and I'm struggling right now. I'm struggling right now as someone who's been here a long time, and I'll wear that like a badge of honor every single day that I'm here. I get it. I know how this place works. On the one hand, I want to jump up and vote yes, because we have an obligation to do something. On the other hand, I am chafing at the notion that we're going to give more power to the executive. And it's not Governor Cuomo. It's the executive. That's what I'm struggling with. So I walked in here, not cavalierly, and not predetermined on how I was going to vote, because my colleagues and I were actually having this discussion. What do you think? Where should we go on this? I could have easily just jumped up and said, I'm voting yes. But I would not have been able to go out of here tonight and say, you know, I wish I had said something. As soon as I saw this legislation, I knew I was going to get up. And I'm no different or any better than anyone here. I think our members grapple with the same types of things. So I actually came in to listen to my colleagues, because this is for sure not the last time we're going to be addressing this issue in terms of the coronavirus, this issue in terms of public health, and this issue, sure as heck, about executive power and authority and privilege and discretion. Mr. President, I appreciate the courtesies of my colleagues, your indulgence, and Senator Gennaris, thank you for answering my questions.
Senator Lanza.
Thank you, Mr. President. On the bill.
Senator Lanza, on the bill.
So we're about to vote on a piece of legislation that cedes enormous power from the legislature to the executive. The ink is barely dry. None of us really, in all honesty, have had the ability to read it, to digest it, to understand it. Now, Mr. President, I've been here long enough to know that when you get up and talk about a piece of legislation, especially one that has the importance of the legislation before us, that some idiot's going to tweet that you don't care about coronavirus, that you don't care about the emergency. It happens on both sides. It doesn't make it right. It's still wrong. My good friend, Senator Gennaris, said that it's not the time to play politics. I agree completely, Mr. President, but that's exactly what's happening here. I'm not going to blame Senate Democrats or Senate Republicans. I don't think anyone in this room, quite frankly, is playing politics with this. But I know someone is, and we all know someone is. I want to talk about the process and a little about the merits. You know, it's a dirty little secret that elected officials like emergencies sometimes because it gives them the opportunity to look presidential, allows them to stand up and act like a leader, gives them the opportunity to prove to the people back home that they know what needs to be done. You know, a lot of people have been talking about this for a couple of months now. I know myself and others on this side of the aisle, some of my friends across the aisle, last month said something needs to be done. You know, but you were a xenophobe if you talked about the fact that this was an emergency only a month ago. In fact, the president, when I think rightly, very early, said that we ought to screen people coming from the affected area in China with a travel ban. He was called a xenophobe, a bigot, and a racist by some pretty highly prominent elected officials in this country. I know people are shaking their head, they agree with that, but not because of what he did. I wondered aloud, what are we doing in New York, and when are we going to talk about it? And I reached out to the health department, both in the state and the city. And we were repeatedly told that there wasn't a problem. In fact, early this afternoon, I saw our governor doing a press conference on the subject, Mr. President. And I listened very intently. Why? First, I consider him a personal friend. I do. He's intelligent. He speaks well. You figure if anyone has all the facts concerning the real emergency, concerning the coronavirus, it must be our governor. And most importantly, he's Italian. So I listened. And what did the governor tell us? We've had our first confirmed case in New York. It was inevitable. We knew it was happening. We knew it was coming. It's not a problem. Nothing to worry about. In fact, for all, he didn't say this, but I can tell you last month when people like me said, what are we doing? As is always the case when you question people in government, I was called a fearmonger. There's no real threat. That's what was said. And in fact, the proof of that is we were here last week, nothing happened. We were here the week before, nothing happened. The week before that, nothing happened. So I just assumed that I was wrong. There was no emergency. Nothing to see here. Move along. Today the governor said, we have the best healthcare system in the world. I believe that. The flu is more dangerous. I don't know what to believe anymore. You try to inform the people back home. I want to be able to tell the people of Staten Island, you should worry or you shouldn't worry. 2 weeks ago, if I told them they should worry, I was a fearmonger. This morning, the governor confirmed that. We knew it was coming. This is not a surprise. There's no danger. People shouldn't worry. Now, unless something very significant changed between that press conference and now, you have to wonder, why is it that we are now faced with a piece of legislation that in effect allows the governor to declare martial law? Is it that serious? Certainly coronavirus, pandemic, the potential for it is very dangerous. Is this the answer? Is this the only answer? My good friend Senator Gennaris talked about the fact, well, there's an emergency. Aren't you worried about emergencies? We have hurricanes and earthquakes and floods, he said. Well, if this is the only way to deal with emergencies, then why make it 14 months? It ought to be permanent, because after all, there's always a risk of hurricanes and earthquakes and floods. If this were the only way to do it, why not do it on a 30-day basis? Again, I'm asking questions. I know that's wrong around here. God forbid you ask questions. Here's the piece of legislation. Swallow it. 14 months, 18 months, 3 years, whatever it says. Better agree with it, or you're a pro-pandemic. That's how it works around here. It's sick. It really is. Is it a legitimate question to ask whether or not it ought to be on a 30-day revolving basis? We come back here in 30 days. If the emergency is still imminent, we get the chance to do this all again. Are we allowed to ask that as a legislature? And I'm looking around this chamber. All good friends. All good friends, Democrat and Republican. And I see the expressions on people's faces here. I'll speak for you. You'll have your turn and get up and say I was wrong. I don't think anybody agrees that this is the right process. And again, I'm not blaming anyone on that side or this side. We're being jammed. It's the way it works around here. We got that Hobson choice. Vote for this or go home. Vote no and you're pro-coronavirus. You're pro-pandemic. Not the way it's supposed to be. It isn't the way it's supposed to be. And my friends, we all know it. But we're stuck. We are stuck because there is a serious threat here. It's real. Maybe if the governor has the power to declare martial law, the threat will go away, it'll dissipate. $40 million? Why not? He's already got $1 billion. Governor already has the power to declare an emergency. $40 million. I guess it allows people to go home and say, see, I did something. Look at me. Look at me. I acted decisively with strength and conviction. But again, I ask the question, did anything change between the press conference and now? We were here this morning. I heard my good friend, Senator Gennaris, ask my good friend, Mr. President, is there any other business before at the desk? The answer was no, there is not. That wasn't 3 weeks ago, that was a couple hours ago. But in between then, I'm getting to an end here sometime, Senator Savino. But now, we've got this hastily put together piece of legislation that again gives the executive even more broad, unconditional power that goes way beyond what would be necessary to deal with the pandemic. Remember, it was only last week that we were told by the same people, not by him, but I know by people in his administration that are the experts when it comes to health and disease and pandemic, they told us the flu represents a greater threat. You all heard it. We all heard it. Shame on me, I believed it. I went home and I told my people. I like to call my people out there on Staten Island. It's okay. The flu is more dangerous. Let's keep this in perspective. Let's take precautions, let's wash our hands. Let's avoid contact, close contact with people who may be evidencing symptoms. But it's okay. There's a mixed message here. This is why people don't believe us. Not us. Government. They don't believe us. They don't know what to believe. Everything's okay. A cold is worse. 5 minutes later, martial law. 5 minutes later, martial law is the only thing that will save us. What are people to think? I'm chuckling because it's sad, but it's confusing. People are going to watch this. The same people who watched that press conference that I saw earlier, who I hope believed our governor. I believed him. Now we're going to say, but wait a minute. If that was true, why is the legislature basically saying, here, you can do our job too. We're going to go home. You've got it all. If I'm sitting back home, I'm thinking, wow, they're not telling us something. They're hiding something. It's human nature to think that. There's got to be something else going on. All that stuff about this being the common cold, it's a big lie. They know. They're getting ready for something. It does not engender confidence. It just doesn't. And again, we're being stuck with this. My friends on the Democratic side and on the Republican side, I cast aspersion to no one in this room. I blame no one in this room. This is, I guess, comes with the territory. But it shouldn't be this way. And now we've got to figure out what to tell people back home. Is the world coming apart? Is it all about to end to the point now that the legislature is basically saying, no mas? Gov, you take it. Senator Sepulveda like that. So again, you know, we're going to have to vote for this, I think. I don't want to speak for everyone here. It's difficult not to. You want to give the governor? I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do because I think it's a dangerous piece of legislation. I do. I think ultimately, I'm thinking aloud here, again, because I didn't have the liberty of actually sitting down for a couple of minutes. Still haven't seen it in hard copy. I'm trusting what people are saying about it. There's no way to vote on legislation. It happened over the years I'm here. Both sides. I guess if you're going to vote yes, you're going to count on that rescission clause. You're going to count on the fact that you trust the governor. He's not going to abuse this awful power that he's being given. Remember, people, when given the opportunity, though, good and bad people alike tend to abuse it when they get it. So we're going to have to be mindful. We're going to have to keep our eye on it here. This is a terrible, terrible way to go about a very, very serious problem. Thank you, Mr. President.
Senator Borello.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise to speak on the bill.
Senator Borello on the bill.
Thank you. In my time as county executive, we had crisis come up that required quick action by our legislature. And, you know, that's why the last page, the appropriation page, makes sense. Here's the money. Here's what it's for. We did that many times. It was never an opportunity for an amazingly bold power grab. And even though I was a Republican and we had a majority of Republicans in our legislature, had I tried something like that, my Republican colleagues would have said, no, we are not going to grant you ridiculous oligarch-type power for the purpose of addressing this particular issue. That's why the rest of this bill makes no sense to me. You know, I don't know, sometimes it's this quote is attributed to Saul Alinsky, sometimes it's attributed to Rahm Emanuel, but never let a crisis go to waste. That's what's going on here. We're taking this coronavirus and we're and giving the governor an opportunity to have sweeping changes. Now, I know that there is this, you know, allocation that will allow this legislature to rescind whatever he might do, potentially. But any legislature that would cede this much power to the executive will likely be reluctant to take it away, no matter how egregious those actions might be. And this law actually allows the governor to not just suspend or rescind, but actually to write new laws. You're giving the governor the power to write legislation on his own. That's the very definition of a dictatorial action. So I understand that this is a politically charged issue. People are emotional about this. And if it was all this was the appropriations page, I'd be happy to support this. And I may take some shots from whomever, but I know that my constituents are smart enough to see through this and to see what an egregious power grab this is by the governor. Never let a crisis go to waste. And that's what's going on here, and I will be voting no. Thank you, Mr. President.
Senator Todisco.
Mr. President, would the sponsor yield for a few questions?
Does the sponsor yield?
Sure.
Sponsor yields.
Thank you, Senator Gennaris. Senator, I think we both agree, we all agree that every single individual in here cares about stemming the tide on this particular coronavirus. We want to protect our constituents. We want to go home tonight and put our head on our pillow and say we did everything we could tonight to help the governor, the assemblyman, the senators here, our state government, our health officials, make sure that this does not expand. And we're not only talking about New York State, we're talking about it's coming from other countries around the world, globally. So this could go outside of New York State. I think we all agree upon that. And the first question I have to ask you, this is an emergency piece of legislation, an emergency piece of legislation related to the coronavirus, giving the governor extended power to make decisions with the $40 million on how we can best do that to protect our constituents in the state. That's what it is, an emergency piece of legislation to give the governor expanded power to do some things normally the legislature and he would be involved with. Is that what this is for the coronavirus?
This is a piece of legislation that is intended to deal with the coronavirus crisis in an emergency fashion.
And it gives, would the gentleman yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
And it gives the governor expanded powers to do that. Okay. Would the senator yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
Now, if someone was sitting in this chambers with the coronavirus, could the chamber start on fire and this building start on fire in and of itself that that individual had the coronavirus?
I don't know how to answer that question. Like, you're asking if the person could spontaneously combust?
Do you think so?
I'm not equipped to answer that question. I'm not enough of a health professional to know whether someone with coronavirus might spontaneously light on fire. I do not know.
Would the gentleman yield for another question?
Does the senator yield?
Yes.
Senator yield.
If someone had that virus, would it cause a flood in the building right now?
I don't know.
You don't know if it would cause a flood if someone had the coronavirus?
Mr. President, I don't know what Senator Todisco is trying to get at. But we are dealing with a very serious issue where people, thousands of people around the world have died in a very short period of time. People on the west coast of the United States in just a matter of days were identified to have contracted this virus, and now they have multiple deaths, and now we know that someone in New York has contracted this virus. So asking whether someone who has the virus will cause a flood or spontaneously combust or light on fire or whatever Senator Tedesco is asking is all sophistry that's beside the point. We are trying to deal with a very real crisis. We're trying to appropriate monies so the state can act quickly to deal with it and save lives in New York. That's what this legislation does.
Thank you, Senator. Would the gentleman yield again?
The Senator yields.
Yes.
Senator yields.
Well, the reason why I asked for a fire and a flood, because that's what it gives extended power to the governor here, for a fire or a flood emergency. So I think the answers to the first two questions were no. But could it cause an earthquake if the individual here had the coronavirus?
I'm going to answer that I don't know to the whole list of possible disasters. So if Senator Tedesco would like to stipulate to that, we could save ourselves a lot of time.
Would the gentleman yield?
Yes.
Senator yields.
So I guess that's no. Someone with the coronavirus couldn't cause an emergency with a fire, couldn't cause an emergency with a flood, couldn't cause an emergency with an earthquake. And I guess I won't ask you the other ones, but I'll mention them. A hurricane, a tornado. I don't know if the virus causes high wind, but I'm seeing some high wind from your side of the aisle here. I hope you don't have it. A landslide, I don't think it could cause a mudslide. A wind, a storm, wave action, a volcano activity. These are all in the legislation. We're giving the governor expanded powers. I don't believe this is The Walking Dead, okay? And I hope it's not. But I'm going to ask you another question, and I think you'll answer this one right. Could it cause an epidemic if they were in this room, or expand an epidemic? Could it cause a disease outbreak right here in our area because of that, and probably cause some air contamination if there was someone in this room?
Mr. President, I'm going to say again, this is not an issue to be made light of. So I'm sitting here listening to my colleague talking about whether someone is passing wind in this chamber. There are people dying as we speak because of this. There are people dying, and Senator Tedesco is making fart jokes on the floor of the Senate. So maybe that tells us all we need to know. We're trying to appropriate money and give the state power to deal with an impending crisis that we expect to reach our state. We know someone already has contracted the virus in New York, and just today on the West Coast in Washington State, people have died because of this. So I don't think it's a time to be making jokes like that. And frankly, I'm offended. As I said earlier, you want to vote no, that's your right as a legislator, and your constituents can decide whether they like what you did or not. But we're here because I've sat here for a long time, and I've watched messages of necessity come and go. I don't think I've ever seen a message more necessary than this one. I've seen all sorts of crap come through this chamber in a message of necessity that the other side of the aisle, when they were in the majority, threw at us with even less notice than you're dealing with. I'm not sorry you're in the minority. I'm glad you're in the minority, but I'm sorry you haven't experienced what we had to experience for 10 years when you were in charge. But this is actually a genuine emergency that requires immediate action. So if there was ever a time when this process that exists to pass something with a message was appropriate, this is it. So save your breath. You know, there's a budget coming up. You'll have a lot of things you're going to have a lot more merit on to criticize and have a debate on. This isn't it, my colleagues.
The Senator yields.
Yes.
Senator yields.
It wasn't a fart joke. It was a hot air joke coming from your side. But the epidemic, disease outbreak, and air contamination, I think you were saying yes to that. If someone was in this room with the epidemic, a disease outbreak, or air contamination, if they had it, it could spread through here. That's why I am going to vote for this, because that language is in there. But you understand, Mr. Gennaris, with all that hot air you were talking about before, the reason I asked you about all those other things, they have nothing to do with the coronavirus. Let's see, fire, flood, earthquake, hurricane, tornado, hot water, landslide, mudslide, windstorm, has nothing to do with the coronavirus. But these three things do. And because those three things do, it could cause an epidemic. It could cause a disease outbreak in here. I'm going to vote for this bill. I'm going to vote for the $40 million. And I'm not making a joke here. What I'm telling you is, you wasted a lot of time with the governor giving him this power that doesn't relate to what we're trying to do here. We're trying to stop an epidemic, a disease outbreak, and air contamination. Those three things make sense. I won't vote against this because that's the right thing to spend money on. All the other things is ancillary because they're not going to start a fire here if they have it. They're not going to cause a flood, an earthquake, or a hurricane. You know that, I know that, the governor knows that. I think what we're saying here, why is all that in this bill for? All you need is to stop the epidemic, the disease outbreak, and the air contamination. And all of my colleagues would vote for it. But I can't go home and not vote for this because that is in there. But I guess what I'm saying to you, this is serious. I agree. And those three or four words make it serious to me to vote for. But the question I'm asking, and I think it's an appropriate one, is why do we have to have all those other issues in there, which you laughed about a little bit, but the answers to all these, and I'm not going to ask them another question. You could sit down, Senator, and I appreciate you and thank you for asking and answering those questions. On the bill. And the reason why I asked the senator, the sponsor of this bill, about the governor getting extended powers for a fire, a flood, an earthquake, a hurricane, that's hot air. None of that can take place with somebody who has the coronavirus. If anything, we want to be honest to our constituents. We want to let them know we're doing something serious and realistic. The fact that you have an epidemic, a disease outbreak, and air contamination, that makes it serious to me. I'm going to vote for it because of that. But really, the rest of it is telling your constituents, for some reason, you had to give the governor all this power. Now, I don't know what the negotiations are. But if the negotiation said, we're not going to do anything unless you give me power over fire, water, earthquake, hurricanes, and tornadoes, and you had to accept it because of that, well, so be it. Now, I'm going to vote for it because I can't go put my head on the pillow when I go home because there are those things that will, hopefully, the governor will use it appropriately. It does concern me that this is an overreach. It does concern me that you're not coming back to the legislature to be a part of where that money is being spent. But I can't go home and tell my constituents I'm not going to protect in those issues, in those areas, which do relate to stopping this coronavirus from spreading to my constituents in the 49th Senatorial District. I thank you, Mr. President.
Senator LaValle.
Thank you, Mr. President. As everyone knows, this is a
Are you on the bill or are you asking the sponsor? I'm asking the senator questions.
Pardon me?
Are you speaking on the bill?
On the bill.
Senator LaValle on the bill.
So again, this is a very serious matter. And people that send us here to protect their health and welfare. And certainly, what we're talking about right now is doing just that. It is critically important as people beyond this chamber listen to this debate that they see this chamber unified in wanting to do something to protect them. Does this legislation give the governor broader powers than maybe we would want him to have? Yeah. But on the other hand, we have to start someplace. And I think we are in the first inning of a nine-inning game. So all of us have been watching television, talking to people, friends, neighbors, constituents. And there's a lot of fear out there. There is a lot of fear out there. So it is important that we speak with one voice, that we tell people with that one voice that we care about them, that we have a plan, and we want to move forward to protect them and their families and our neighborhoods. So it's not about the governor, because the governor is going to have to explain to people, just like we have to explain to people, how we vote or legislation that we propose, whether we overreach or not. And that is not for me to decide, but time will play this out. This is not the first discussion that we're going to have on this issue, I would think. So I'm going to support this legislation, and I hope that all of us can support it so that we speak with one voice strongly, that we are focused in protecting the health and welfare of the people that we represent and the people of this state.
Are there any other senators wishing to be heard? Seeing and hearing none, debate is closed. The secretary will ring the bell. Read the last section.
Section 4, this act shall take effect immediately.
Right. Call the roll.
Dobble, Fennigan, Janaris, Cougar, Stewart, Cousins, Thomas.
To explain her vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I don't think anybody is taking what we're doing here lightly. I see the anguish that so many of you have expressed, the questions the conversation, the postulations, all of it appropriate. And then, as we go through the stages of why are we here, we remember. We remember that globally, there are 87,137 confirmed cases. In China alone, 79,968, 2,873 deaths. Outside of China, 7,169 confirmed, 58 countries, 104 deaths. Expanded local transmission in South Korea, Japan, Iran, Italy. In the United States, total cases, 43. Total hospitalized, 17. Total deaths, 2. States reporting cases, 10. New York State reporting a case today, 1. Almost 20 million people are depending upon us in this state to act because we are not talking about a flu, nor is there a reason to panic, but there is a reason to act. We could continue to talk, and we will. We can continue to debate whether or not there's an overreach of power. I think we all are looking at a lot of different ways that maybe this could have transpired. But the reality is, our state and our nation continues to look for leadership, and we, probably better than most places, have the ability to act. We have the facilities, we have the personnel, and quite honestly, I know Senator Flanagan expressed great confidence in the national scene. I have confidence in New York paying attention to what's important and doing what's right for our people. That's why we're here today. That's why we're acting now. We have one case, we can keep talking, but I think people expect us to do what we came to do, and that's to protect them. I vote aye.
Leader Stewart-Cousins will be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
In relation to calendar number 524, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Borrello, Helming, Rivera, and Salazar. Absent from voting, Senators Akshar, Carlucci, Sanders, and Rivera. Ayes 53, nays 4. Pardon me. Absent from voting, Senators Akshar, Carlucci, Sanders, and Ranzenhofer. Pardon me. Ayes 53, nays 4.
The bill is passed. Senator Gennaris, that completes the reading of the controversial calendar.
Is there any further business at the desk?
There's no further business at the desk.
Move to adjourn until tomorrow, Tuesday, March 3rd at 3 p.m.
On motion, the Senate stands adjourned until Tuesday, March 3rd at 3 p.m.